Hi, I'm Andrew Strom, and today I'm going to walk you through a starter project in Kumiko. And Kumiko is a decorative form of Japanese lattice work. It's often found in architectural elements in a Japanese home, things like shoji screens, which are room partitions, or window transoms. And you can see that it's geometric in form. This particular pattern is called the asa-no-ha. And it's based on the hemp leaf, which is a very traditional motif in Japanese decorative arts. It's also used a lot in textiles. A lot of Japanese decorative arts are actually inspired by nature. So to start out, I'm going to walk you through the tool set that's required. It's a pretty basic set of tools. In this case, I'm going to be using mainly Japanese tools. It seems appropriate, and I happen to own some and enjoy using them, but you can use Western tools as well. So I have a fine Dazuki saw here. If you're using a Western saw, use the finest saw that you've got. I have a marking knife, and using a knife for a lot of the layout work is really critical because the knife line will give us a nice crisp point to work towards. I have a 1/4-inch chisel here. The main bars that we're going to use are about 1/4 inch thick, just to hair over, and so 1/4-inch chisel works nicely for those. I have a wider chisel. You'll see as I'm working on this project that there's a fair bit of paring involved using a guide block, and a wide chisel registers nicely on that particular jig. A ruler, a combination square, double square, machinist square, whatever you happen to have, but since you'll be using a metal knife for layout, then it's important to have a metal blade on the square. And then lastly, a couple of what are called hatagane clamps. These are basically a small brass Japanese bar clamp. These are useful, they're not essential, but you'll see as I work on the project that their low profile is very helpful. So let me show you the different components that make up this particular pattern. You'll see that we've got two thicknesses of bar. We've got a 1/4-inch thick bar making up the main lattice work. We have a thinner bar, it's about 3/16 inch thick, making up the interior of the pattern to give it a little bit of visual lightness. There are 4 different pieces that make up this Kumiko. So there are 6 pieces of the exterior lattice work. And then I'm just going to take it apart, and you can see that it's press fit together. There's actually no glue holding these components. So within each quadrant, we have a diagonal. We have 2 what I call hinge pieces. And this is actually 1 continuous piece that I've cut almost all the way through. I've just left a feather of wood here and then bent it so that it remains intact but takes up this space. And then we have these much shorter locking pieces that, when they're pressed in, exert some force here and put this hinge piece into compression and lock it in place. The hinge piece is probably the most challenging element to cut, but I'm going to go through and show you a systematic technique for being successful with it. So there are 2 essential jigs for cutting this particular pattern, and indeed you will use these if you branch out into other forms of Kumiko. This particular jig is a cutting jig. You can see there's a stop on one side and there's a fence on the back. This fence is 1/4 inch thick, which is actually 1/2 the depth of my Kumiko bars. And so I can use this fence not only to register the stock up against, but when my saw teeth come down and just touch the fence, that serves as a depth stop for me and indicates when I should stop cutting. The second jig, this is a paring jig, and simply a block of wood with a channel cut up the middle and angled cuts on each end. This end is 45 degrees, and this end is 30 degrees. And you use this for pairing those interior elements of the Kumiko pattern. You'll also see that I've cut a saw kerf in this pairing block, and this serves as a miter box for when I cut the kerf in that hinge piece. And then lastly, one little element to point out to you, I've glued a little bit of sandpaper in here to provide some friction so that my Kumiko bars don't move around as I'm working on them. Let me talk for a minute about the material that I'm using today. So I'm using basswood, which is admittedly not a Japanese wood, but as far as the woods that we have in North America, it's a really good choice for this kind of work. You can see it's light in color. It has a very indistinct grain, so that that grain pattern doesn't detract from the overall design. The other thing about basswood is it's moderately hard and also moderately soft, so it has just enough compression so that when we press fit these joints together, there's some force being exerted by the wood itself, and that helps to hold things together. The first thing we do is cut the components for the outer lattice to length. These are 7 3/4 inch long. I've cut 6 of them, and I've also numbered the ends. And that's actually a really important step, because it's important, these pieces, I'm cutting them by hand. So when I register them in the jig, it's important that the numbered ends all go against my stop block here. But also, if there's a slight miscue when I'm cutting the joints themselves, by keeping the parts batched together as they were cut, it will help even out any inconsistencies in my layout and cutting. So the layout is actually fairly straightforward. The outside bars are about 1/4 inch in from the ends, just to leave a little bit of a horn so that the ends of these bars aren't too weak. And then there's one central bar on both axes, and that's right in the middle. I've laid one bar out as a template, and although I've got a number of joints to cut, by gang cutting them, by cutting them all together, you'll see the process actually goes quite quickly. So what I'm going to do is cut the left-hand side of each half lap joint first. Clamp it in place so that it doesn't move around on me. Now I have a knife line at the location of each joint. It's important to make sure everything's registering and that my pieces are registered positively against the stop block. So I was mentioning earlier that this fence is 1/4 inch thick, and it'll act as a guide to show me when to stop cutting. On this side of the cut, I'm just going to use a scrap piece of wood that's the same thickness. It's important to be aware of what the waist side of the line is. So I've done this enough that I have it memorized, but if you want, just mark an X. So you register the saw just on the waist side of the line, get it started, and then drop it just adjacent to the knife line so that the outside of your saw teeth are just coming up against it. And then it's simply a matter of taking, a number of nice even strokes until you touch the fence on this side and that scrap piece of wood on the side closest to you. Next comes a fairly crucial step. I need to determine the position of the second shoulder line of my half lap joints. And to do that, I'm going to use a scrap piece of bar, and I'm going to position it right on the saw cut that I first made, and use my marking knife just to make an indentation of where that saw kerf needs to be. The positioning of this bar is fairly critical. If I have it too far over to the right, there will be a gap in the joint. And if I have it so that the saw kerf is completely covered by the edge of the bar, the joint will be too tight and I won't be able to push the lattice work together. And now I'm going to grab my square, put my knife into that indentation, that mark that I made, bring the square up against it, and then scribe across. And repeat for the other two. There we go. Now I'm going to cut the second shoulder of each joint. So I've got my knife line, and it's important again to remember what the waist side of the line is. In this case, it's just to the left of the line. So I'm going to start the saw at the back and then drop it down. And now I can use my quarter inch chisel to pare out the waste between these saw cuts. As when I was sawing, this piece will serve as a stop, as a guide for my paring. And I can use this scrap in the same way on the other. You can see the waste actually pops out pretty quickly and pretty cleanly. And one of the things I like to do is do a little double check just to make sure the joints are neither too tight nor too loose. You can see the logic behind cutting all these pieces together. Cutting 9 half laps individually would have taken a lot more time. So I can use my scrap piece of bar, and if I just push it in, you can see that's a fairly tight press fit, which is exactly what I want. You can see it presses in nicely. And the same on the third one. So when I go to assemble this, it should go together without any difficulty. So I have my 6 Kumiko that make up my overall lattice work. And this is where the numbering becomes important, that numbering that I did initially. And you can see this piece is actually a little bit shorter than these other two. So that's a really good illustration of the importance of keeping everything aligned. So I've got 1, 2, 3, and then 4, 5, and 6. And I'm just going to start pressing these together. Some joints are a little tighter than others, but what's going well here is not needing to use any excessive force. Just a press fit. And there we go. There's our outside lattice work complete. One of the important elements of maintaining the orientation of the pieces is if I sight down the Kumiko themselves this way and then turn it 90 degrees, what I can see is that there's no distortion in the bars. Sometimes if your layout and your cutting isn't quite perfect, there may be one of the bars bent into a bit of a curve because of that, but in this case, everything's nice and straight. Now that the main lattice work is cut and assembled, the next step is for me to cut and fit these diagonals here. So I need 4 of them. I've cut 5 because it always pays to have a little bit extra. And I've cut them. You can just do a takeoff and direct measure from your grid here about an eighth of an inch longer than their finished size. My first step is to put these in the pairing jig and to pair a 90 degree point on each end. In other words, two 45s. It's going to help if they're all the same length. So I'm going to position the Kumiko in this pairing jig, so that where this surface, this 45 degree angle, intersects the middle of the bar, that it's just a little bit beyond its center point. I've set up a piece of scrap as a positive stop, and the end of this bar is protruding beyond the pairing surface of this jig. It's protruding so that I can pair a 45 degree miter on one side, flip it over, and pair a 45 degree miter on the other side that comes to a nice sharp point. It's easier to demonstrate than to explain. And using the positive stop ensures that all my bars are the same length. What you want is a nice, sharp 90 degree point on the end of this piece, no flat spot, so that it seats all the way into the corner of the lattice work. I've done that for one piece, I'm going to do it for the remaining four. And it goes fairly quickly. You can see because I'm pairing end grain, I'm actually taking a shearing cut. So the width of the chisel blade helps register it positively on the surface of the jig, but it also allows me to sort of slice across. Oops. And sometimes you're left with a little feather, and I can just get rid of that. You see by how much I had to pair on this one. This was longer than all the rest of them, but that's okay. Now that I've got that 90 degree point paired on all of them, so I can actually use one of them, put it into place as it's going to be, and mark where the inside face of this bar intersects with the diagonal. And what that does is it tells me where in the jig, it shows me exactly where in this jig I should place it, clamp my stop block again. And so I'm just going to take, there's my knife line, and it's actually just intersecting, just lining up, aligning with the face of the pairing jig. So this is going to be my test piece. I'm going to pair a 90 degree point on the end of this piece, and we'll see if it fits. It's better if you're being cautious, of course, to leave it a little bit heavy so that you can take wood off if need be. So that's too tight, which is fine. I'm just going to reposition that jig. And because this jig is in a way almost direct reading, I can see exactly how much I'm taking off, and I want to take a little more. There we go. There. So that's a good press fit. Now I'm going to test it in the other openings just to make sure it's actually a little loose there, which is okay. I'm going to test it here. If it's a little tight here, maybe a little loose, but that's probably all right as well. Wow, that's way loose. All right. Yeah, that's still too loose, but I'm gonna try here. Yeah, that's about right. So what I found was that first piece I cut was gonna be a little too loose in the three remaining quadrants. So I've actually backed off on my stop block. It seems to be a good fit here, and I'm gonna guess that it's a decent fit and the one that's opposite to it, which is correct. So now I'm going to cut another piece to fit in that diagonal. But first, let me just see. And you can see it's actually a little bit loose still for this last quadrant. So it's fine here. I'm going to back off on my stop block a little bit more, and what it'll mean is that my four quadrants are not all identically sized, but you'll see nothing in the real world is ever perfect. You'll see we'll still be able to complete the project successfully. There we go. This one in. So there we go. That's our diagonals done. The hinge pieces are probably, as I said, the most complex component to cut in the entire project. I've got a single piece, I'll just sort of straighten it out, that has two 30 degree miters on each end and then a cut that's in the middle. So the first thing I'm going to do is pair these 30 degree miters, but I need to determine how long this piece needs to be overall. And that's tricky to do because it's bent in the middle. The easiest way I found to do this is to actually draw it out full size. And so in this case, we have a drawing, it's full scale, it's actual size, of this particular project. If I measure from the apex here, right in the very corner, to where it meets this locking piece, the distance from here to here is half of my overall length, tip to tip. And so rather than resorting to trigonometry or mathematics or anything like that, as I said, the simplest way, regardless of the size of asa-no-ha that you happen to be making, drafting it out full size and doing a takeoff directly from that is a surefire way of getting very close to the actual dimension that you need. So with the hinge pieces start out their full length. And in the case of this project, I've cut this to about 5 1/4 inches long, giving me a little bit of an allowance, about a 16th of an inch or so. And I'm going to set this piece in the pairing jig so that its underside just lines up with this 30 degree pairing surface. And of course, I'm going to use the same stop block trick and pair that 30 degree miter on all 8 pieces, well, 9 or 10, because again, it helps to cut a couple extra. Make sure it's nice and secure. And you can see, really, one of the benefits of having glued some sandpaper in this channel is that my workpiece doesn't tend to skew in the pairing jig. There we go. Now that I've got a 30 degree miter paired on all my pieces, I'm going to take one and use it as a master template. Ensure that it fits well in all my openings, and then I'll use it as a guide for the remaining pieces. So I've paired 30 degree miter on this end. It's important that the miters are angled up towards the center and that you don't have a parallelogram in section, because then you've got the miters going the wrong way. The next thing I need to do, this is sort of the big trick of the whole project, is to cut. This piece has to bend right in the middle. So I have to cut, I have to make a saw cut in the middle of this piece, most of the way through. The saw cut has to be equidistant from each end, and as I said, most of the way through without actually going through. And here's how you do it. This piece is almost exactly 5 inches long, maybe plus about a 32nd. So I'm just going to make a mark 2.5 plus approximately a 64th. Really important when you're cutting this hinge piece, of course, that you make the saw cut on the correct side. It has to bend like this, not the opposite way. So what I like to do to determine whether my saw cut is aligned or positioned, I should say, in the center is make a cut and then rotate it end for end. And this happens to be pretty much spot on, but any deviation you've got is twice the error. So then you just have to adjust your stop block appropriately one way or the other to get the cut in the right position. So it's about 2 strokes with this particular saw. That's usually just about right. And needs just a little bit deeper. And it pays to be a little careful with this. It's still not quite. So Japanese saws, of course, cut on the pull stroke. You saw that I took a push stroke because I'm trying to remove very little material. There we go. So I like to put my thumbnails, in fact, on either side of that, and just so it supports the fibers as I'm bending it. But there we go, just like that. If it's a little more reluctant than that, sometimes I have just a glass of water and a, you know, cotton swab or a small brush or something like that, and I moisten this side of the hinge, and that will help it. That will help the fibers relax a little bit. So now I can test this. And it seems to be a good fit. I'm going to test it in some other positions. It is projecting, there's a gap at the heel here a little bit, which indicates that it may just be a touch too long. So here's how to know if this piece is actually cut the right length. A gap at the heel means that it isn't, so here's the heel. Gap at the heel means that it isn't going into the corner all the way. So the piece would be a little bit too long. And then here's the toe, that apex right there. If there's a gap at the toe, that means that it's too short. So I'm just going to pare a little bit off this one end. Just and test that theory that it's a shade too long. So very, very small amount. And see if that works better. And there's a bit of a gap, but it's improved. This is probably close. I may take a little bit. I may shorten it just a tiny bit so that it fits perfectly. There we go. So that tiny little hair that I just took off, you can see how neatly that fits. I've gone ahead and finished the remaining hinge pieces based on that first piece that I made as a template. I fit them. I'm reasonably happy with how they fit. There's a little bit of a gap in this one, but I think if I apply some force to it, you'll see it closes up. So the next and final step is to make the locking pieces that go from the corners and interlock with the hinge pieces. They have a different angle at each end. On one end, they have a 90 degree point, and on the opposite end, they have a 60 degree point. So I've got my pieces pre-cut to length a little bit over length, in fact. I've got my stop block set up. Here's my 30 degree angle. I'm going to put that 60 degree point on all 8 pieces. Then use one as a template to get the length. Reset the stop block, reset the jig for my 45 degree pairing surface so that I get the 90 degree point. That's the final piece of the puzzle and locks them in place. You can see that when dealing with a short piece like this, my fingers are actually fairly close in to where the chisel is working, but I'm very conscious of their position. And where the chisel blade is as well. And the chisel is never coming more than about 3/8 to half an inch away. So still quite safe. But it does pay to be slow and deliberate and not rush. So like the diagonals, I'm just going to put this piece in place and mark position of Kumiko bar. I've turned my jig around so that I'm now using the 45 degree end. Just clamp it in place. If you're more comfortable, you can also use the point of your marking knife to hold such a short piece in place. And it is in fact a little bit loose. So, I may be able to use this one elsewhere. Yes, I can. It happens to work well there, but it's too loose to use as a master. So what I'm going to do is move my stop block a little bit and try again. Oh, still a little bit loose. That's okay. That's why we make extra. Maybe still a little too loose. But rather than wasting these pieces, I'm finding a space that they fit. So I'm going to test fit this in a number of different corners. It's a little loose there. It's fine. It's kind of perfect there, actually. Maybe a little tight there. Yeah. But that's okay. and perhaps a little tighten that one as well, but better too tight than too loose. And perfect there. So I think this is a good length to go with because I can always shorten them as I complete the pattern. I'm going to use this position of my stop block to pair the 90 degree points on the remaining 7 walking pieces. There you have it, the completed asa-no-ha pattern. There are myriad Kumiko patterns out there. This is an excellent project to start off with because it gives you the foundational techniques for branching out on your own. Thanks very much for joining us, and we'll see you again next time.